This is Clay Fuller. He's a political scientist, and I talk to him because he studies the modern authoritarian regime.
Authoritarian regimes tend to end just as violently or suddenly as they begin.
That surprised you?
No.
And they are generally horrific in how they deal with individual people and individual rights all around the world.
Does that surprise you?
No.
Authoritarian regimes are all around the world. Corruption is a feature, not a bug.
The American system will go to work doing its job, putting dictators out of business.
I want to turn to Clay Fuller, because I know you've done a lot of analysis, Clay, of transnational criminal organizations, authoritarian aspect that they take on in some countries like Venezuela.
Sure. Well, thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
How did we get it so wrong?
The internet, cryptocurrency, any of these things are just a tool, like a hammer, right? It can be used to build something, or it can be used to cause great harm. It depends on the user.
First, I became an academic because I don't like authority that much. It's a surprise, but I don't like anarchy either, because anarchy is another type of dictatorship. So I spent about 10 years studying modern authoritarian governance around the world. Monopolies on political control within governments in the internet and post-Cold War era. No, I don't think there's really a problem with democracy. It's more with the rule of law.
No creo que haya un problema con la democracia. El problema es con el estado de derecho.
And so what I see when I look around with the trends of that is that in the post-Cold War era, we've integrated with authoritarian countries, and this has had great positive effects for a lot of people all around the world. It's brought a lot of people up out of poverty, has made a lot of people a lot of wealth, and created a lot of development out there. But what's happened, captured this wealth, and they've used it to create things like totalitarian surveillance states.
Authoritarian corruption is essentially the new communist. It involves in place that we have all the things, like, America's built for this. Like, we're already set up for it. We just need the leadership and the sort of direction on where to go. So, for instance, FinCEN, which is the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, part of the U.S. Treasury, could use, you know, some better language on in its mission statement on looking at authoritarian states in particular as the threat that they are. I mean, can we dismantle the ways in which corrupt dictatorships abuse the virtues of democracy and capitalism? We can attack
authoritarian corruption as non-ideological. It's just basic nuts and bolts economics. So our existing institutions, we just need to reorient them towards authoritarian corruption. And then from an international standpoint, the group of seven, right? So getting back to the research on democracies and how this works internationally, I've always looked at the group of seven as being a perfect starting point for sort of reinvigorating democracy around the world, because all seven of those nations are the world's longest standing, most durable capitalist democracies that have ever existed on the planet. So there's natural room for cooperation there to grow out and do this. And with the G7 also, the G7 created in 1989 the FATF, which is the Financial Action Task Force, which is the international norm-setting body on money laundering, anti-money laundering, and countering terrorist financing. They've been hugely instrumental in changing norms and the way that the world has understood, especially countering the financing of terrorism post 9/11. But one issue with that institution is that it's grown very big, very fast.
They're building missile systems. They're building nuclear weapons. They're necessary actions that U.S. law enforcement and government have taken and sanctions. I think we're doing the right thing by pushing back on Venezuela, by pushing back on China, by pushing back on Russia, by pushing back on Iran.
The notion of the difference between democracies and autocracies is a very simple way to do this. If you take the 100 people in the United States and ask them, you're likely to get about 80 to 100 different answers. If you go to Russia in 2000 or 2018 and ask 100 Russians to control Russia, you're going to get one of two answers. If you go to China and you ask 100 Chinese who runs China, you're going to get one of two answers. Are he or we or me? That's how you tell the difference between a democracy and an autocracy.
Enforcing that wealth and that capital is so vicious. act with impunity around there while creating structures that then move that money in, move that value into the United States and around there. So we've squeezed this balloon. We force them in to work together. This is why Venezuela is pushing money out through obscure Russian banks and creating the ironic sovereign cryptocurrencies that, you know, doesn't really make much sense to me as an academic. But thinking of that, the money is being squeezed into the United States. I really like the America First approach. I love America, but I see it a little bit differently. Where I think we need to be focusing on America, right, and focusing on catching where this money is coming in and exposing it and stopping it there. And I think this is done through, like we've heard before, beneficial ownership, transparency.